Good morning. Here we are at the World Forum for Democracy 2016, and we're delighted to be able to talk to Peter Hartkamp. You're from the Netherlands, and we learned that you managed, with the cooperation of your inspectors in the Netherlands, to start up a school. Well, it's a complicated story, which I hope that you can tell us a little bit about. But you wrote a book, Beyond Coercive Education, which has come out quite recently. And in it, you pose some very testing questions. And I would just like to put back to you three of the questions that you ask. Maybe you can fill us out a little bit on these. Why do we constantly test children? Why is education coercive? And why is there so much bullying in schools? So those are the three questions that really caught my eye.
Okay. Well, about the coercive is, of course, in the title of the book. We had a pretty long story in Holland of 15 years of dealing with democratic schools. And the last 2 years, it's really accepted. But then I decided to write down my insights from all the troubles we had. And then when I start looking at the education, I think all the problems in education you can relate back to the coercion in schools. Mm-hmm. So it's not necessarily the type of education, of the education model or the pedagogy, but it's the forcing of children. I think, and that's basically what the whole book is about. Because to me, forcing of children is really against the rights of the child.
And how does that lead to bullying in schools, for example?
If you look at bullying, in schools there's a hierarchy. And there's the people with power and the people without power. And I think in any setting, whether you look at prisons or armies or schools, you see there's bullying. And I think the bullying is the result from the power distance and being powerless in the schools. And I think like in democratic schools, in our schools, I haven't seen any bullying at all. Because children have equal power with the other people. If there's something happens, they can actually take action and they have a mechanism to actually deal with it.
Okay. So I think that we get the basic idea. Margarita, do you want to?
Yes. You're also telling a personal story in your book, and I'm interested in what brought you to democratic education and what are your experiences as a father? And
because I have nothing. Before that, I'm trained as a mining engineer, nothing to do with education, and actually wanted to keep it that way. But then when my oldest daughter was about 8 years old, she said we'd rather be dead than go to school. And that for us as parents was really a trigger, because we have to do something. If we cannot accept that we are forced by the government to put our children in a system, which makes her completely depressed and this the result. So then we started to do something. And then we started looking for alternatives, and we finally came with democratic education.
Where did you take your inspiration from?
Our daughter was the trigger. When we started reading the books of the Sudbury Valley School,
I see.
Initially I thought, well, this is weird, it can't be, but that was my own, I think, the way I was conditioned by my own schooling. When I started reading it, I said, oh, but this is really great. I think this is something I really believe in. But then, of course, it wasn't around in Holland, so we actually had to start school, and that's what we did.
And do you think that, I mean, you must be very pleased that Jacob Hecht is the keynote speaker at this event in Strasbourg. Do you think he's got the message over that you would like?
I hope so, but probably have to ask the other participants of the forum, because I think we've had a pretty clear story.
Can you tell us a bit about him?
About the importance of democracy in schools and giving children equal say and equal rights and in charge of their own lives. And I think at the end, Jacob made this proposal of having 10% of democratic times in all schools, similar to like Google had 20% of free time. Where major things came out. Let's just start it, and also in the coercive school system and all the traditional schools. Let's treat children like people and ask them what they need and what they want, and let them decide for themselves.
And he's started up 30 schools in Israel. Is that right?
Yeah, yeah. They started 30 years ago, I think. Yes. He started the first one, and now there's like 30 democratic schools in Israel. and they're supported by the state or funded by the state, because that's a problem with a lot of democratic schools. Within the rules of the state funding, a democratic school in most countries is not possible, so it has to be a private school. But if it's a private school, it's not accessible for a lot of people because it's expensive. But I think it's a major role for governments here to get away from the coercion in education and make alternatives possible.
And that's the importance about the 10% call.
I think it's a start, a 20% call.
20%,
it was.
Yeah, sorry.
Now I think that really, if you start thinking about it, people have to start thinking about what are we doing and what's democratic mechanisms, because democracies in schools is not about the choice of the meals or the color of the walls. It's about what do you do in schools and how can you prepare yourself for your future life.
And do you think it's important that we're beginning to see an international movement now?
Well, it already is an international movement, I think. There's more than 1,000 schools worldwide.
Yes.
But of course, only in Holland, which is a pretty small country, there are like 7,000 primary schools. So 1,000 democratic schools worldwide is not very much. But it's growing, but it needs to grow much faster, I think.
And do you think it's successfully present at this conference as an international movement?
Yeah, I think it was... We get it across as more sessions, of course, like Simone is telling a story about her own experience. I think that's really very powerful. But we have to see, but I think we just have to do more. Because also if you see the problems with democracy all over the world at the moment, can we train children in coercive schools and authoritarian schools to prepare for life as a democratic citizen? And I think it's a whole crazy concept. You keep children tied down in schools for 12 years of their life and then say, okay, now you're responsible yourself, now you're democratic citizens, go.
You are not only a school founder, you are also working in an organization. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, all the democratic schools are really small. And in Europe, we have the European Democratic Education Community, which is an association of all people, institutions, and schools which want to support democratic education and make it as a viable alternative for democratic societies, basically. And there's members now from 28 countries, and it's creating a lot of support and enthusiasm, and people coming to annual conferences to see how they can start democratic schools.
And this is UDEC?
It's called UDEC, yes.
Jakob Hecht was talking about IDEC.
UDEC is an organization. There's something actually which started it all, which was the International Democratic Education Conference,
okay.
Which is an annual international conference on democratic education, which has been around, I think the first one was in 1993, and has been every year since. And I think at the IDEC conferences in Leipzig in 2007, a group of people from Europe decided to start UDEC.
I see.
And also there's now the Asia Pacific Democratic Education Community started. There's a North American Education Community started. So you see it all over the world now, basically.
And IDEC is in Israel coming up?
The next
right?
IDEC will be held, yes, in 2017 in, I think, April in Israel.
And what do you hope might be achieved there?
Well, the focus of the conference is really interesting. And in Israel, they already achieved a good relationship between democratic schools and the government. Because the government in most countries has a complete monopoly on education almost. So you need government to work together and to be able to make it possible and make it available. And I think Israel is a good showcase. And I think other countries can learn a lot from that.
And why was the Israeli government willing to go down this route, do you believe?
You have to ask Jakob Hecht, and I know. I think there was a special circumstances in Israel and support. And of course, also Israel is a pretty small country. So if you have the right connections and the right ideas to the right people, a lot can happen very fast.
Of course, it's very proud of being a democratic society. So
yeah.
This might have also been a factor.
Yep. Now, I think for a democratic society, it's only logical to have also democratic schools. I think having autocratic schools in a democratic society doesn't make any sense to me.
Were you surprised that both Georges Haddad and Jakob Hecht in the plenary session yesterday seemed to agree on that point, that somehow the conventional way of doing things has run out of answers for the challenges that face us today?
I'm not surprised because I think it's such a logical thought. I mean, don't see how you can think otherwise. I think what we need to do is actually to make it work and to make it happen. And I think maybe the Council of Europe can also play a role there, because I think if you look at the rights of the child in traditional schools at the moment, they violate it on a large scale. I think like bullying is a violation of the rights of the child. So I think we should completely stop it, like we stopped corporal punishment 25 years ago. But I think the realization that also inside schools children have rights is really important, and we need to act on that.
Well, thank you, Peter.
Thank you very much.